Hey guys, we're in the foresty area just on the outskirts of Seattle. It's a perfect place, especially given this gravelly trail, for the Rad Power Bikes Rad Rover. This is a bike that really just started it all in my mind for the company, and also has made a big impact on the space in general because people, I think, are attracted to these big, like, fat tires. They look like they can go anywhere, and they really do offer some cushion. They offer traction. So whether you're on gravel, softer terrain like this, I'm originally from Colorado where it snows a lot. So, you know, if you want to hop out there and not worry so much about sliding around, maybe you live somewhere where the streets are a little rough. Maybe you want to go on the beach. I actually did that in Mexico, had some of these bikes flown down at one point because there was a company hoping to use them for, like, tourism, you know, and take people on the rides. And it actually worked. The tires, the wheels, that's really what's so exciting about this bike to me. These are 26 by 4 inch, so 4 inch is like how fat they are, and they have a PSI range, a pressure range of 5 to 30. So if you're someone who's riding around on relatively, you know, hard packed gravel like this, or maybe concrete, you take it up to 30 and they're gonna be efficient. They're gonna be rolling really smoothly. If you take it down to 5, that's when you can go and you start to float and you can travel right over soft terrain, sand and stuff like that. Fat tires are neat because you don't have to worry so much about pinch flats. You've got this cool, like, comfy look, but that's not the only part of this bike that's geared towards comfort. Check out this big suspension fork. It's a spring fork, so a little bit heavier than, like, some of the fancy air forks, but it does have lockout, and then we've even got preload adjust over here. It's 100 millimeters of travel, you know, quick release over here, so it's 9 millimeter. We're not working with, like, a through axle or some really fancy super high-end stuff, but I actually think it's a decent fork, and the fact that they got the light mounted to it right there, really good. And then in the back, we've got a 750 watt Bafang fat tire specific motor. See how it's extra wide? So that gives the spokes a better bracing angle. I like that they've gone with black spokes in this case. They blend in a little bit nicer. Extra thick 12 gauge versus a lot of bikes just have 14 gauge. So, you know, we're working with the bigger tires. We've got a big, very capable motor. This is an internally geared motor from Bafang, 750 watt output. And what that means is you get this zippier feel compared to, like, the Rad City or the Rad Wagon. They have a gearless direct drive motor and it has a little bit of regen. So when you pull the brake lever, there's a little bit of recuperation happening. Some of the energy is flowing back towards the battery. This doesn't do this, but this freewheels, so you don't have a little bit of that magnetic drag. It's also a little bit lighter, so it's about 13 pounds versus 15 pounds. The batteries on all the bikes for 2018 are the same. So they've upgraded from 48 volt 11.6 amp hour to 48 volt 14 amp hour, 7.7 pounds on this pack, really nicely situated, keeps weight low and center. It looks nicer than some of the older packs. They had, like, this silver button you had to push before you turned on the display. That's no longer the case. You just lock the battery onto the bike and then you do everything up here at the cockpit. You don't have to bend down, which to me is nice. They've also got the power charging port way up high, so it's not interfering with the pedals, and it's gonna be a little bit easier to keep out of the way, in my opinion. You know, I'm always thinking about, like, oh, am I gonna trip over it? Here it is. I put the charger out so I could show you guys. 1.1 pounds, relatively lightweight, kind of a cheaper, more basic charger. 2 amp output. There are some e-bikes now that have, like, 4 amp chargers, but they tend to be more expensive and a little bit heavier. So price is one of the big factors with all the Rad Power bikes. This is $14.99. All their bikes are that price, except for the Wagon, which is $15.99. So, you know, considering that, in my opinion, that's more value price point. The way they're able to do that is it's kind of a direct-to-consumer company, so you buy it online and then they'll ship it to you for free, or for $100 extra, you can have Velofix receive the bike, build it up for you and deliver it, and they'll even do a tune-up after, like, 30 days, something like that, which is nice. Like, maybe you don't live near a bike shop, or maybe your bike shop isn't super e-bike friendly. You know, I'm trying to do my best to give you an overview of this thing. The best thing would be to ride it, but there are so many Rad Power bikes out there now, and the Rad Rover is probably their most popular. You should get a chance to do that. So another difference between 2017 to 2018 is that the stem here is a lot shorter and it's, like, kind of angled up. So what that does is it moves your body position back and up for more comfort. And then they've got these mid-rise handlebars, so you could angle them forward for a longer reach, or back and up like this, which I've done for kind of that upright feel, and you can look around pretty easily. Your back and neck might not get so sensitive. Ergonomic grips. These are not locking, but they're kind of that stitched faux leather look, you know, and they match, they blend in with the saddle back here, Velo plush, and it's got an integrated handle. 27.2 millimeter width on that seat post. So if you're someone who wants to go all the way to comfort, you could have that suspension fork, which comes stock, and then you could pay a little bit extra, and they have an SR Suntour NCX suspension seat post. So now you've got some comfort here and here, you lower the tire pressure, you bring the handles up, and you're sitting pretty. I mean, it's neat. Like, I've been riding all their bikes around because I'm visiting them at their headquarters, and this is one of my favorites because it's just so comfortable and fun. Really, that's the feeling I get when I look at this. I love that now they have also sort of upgraded the paint job, so it's this white glossy with orange accents, and then over here we have this matte black with kind of the gray accents, and you can see this one's completely tricked out. It's got the plastic fenders, extra wide, so they give you plenty of coverage. It is wet in Seattle sometimes, right? And we've got this rack that you can order, and it just bolts on, right? But it's actually seems pretty secure to me. It's like one of the more burly racks, and it's custom designed, so it has like a kind of a quick fit for this Yep seat. If you're maybe someone who's bringing kids around, you could set that up and have them sitting right behind you, and there's enough clearance here behind the seat that you can actually do that. I do want to call out though, the saddle's probably not going to be able to go quite as low if you do get this rear rack, because it's going to collide right here. Even if you slide it forward, it's not completely forward on those rails. Just think about that. Same thing goes for the suspension seat post. So if you order that suspension post, you know, it adds like a few inches right there, and you're not going to be able to quite go as low. Only comes in one size right now, but that top tube is really sloped, so it's designed to give you a lower standover height and make this bike more approachable. This is the heaviest bike in the Rad Power Bikes lineup at about 66.5 pounds. So, you know, it's like you kind of expect that, especially with the suspension fork and the bigger tires and stuff. All those accessories are going to add a little bit of weight too. So 66.5, that's like the naked bike that we're looking at right here. Other things I want to call out. In addition to that kind of like stepped in down tube that brings the battery a little bit lower and tighter, it's connected at three points, so it's really sturdy. You know, there are a lot of electric bikes and kits that they just bolt them into like bottle cage bosses where there's only two anchor points. So having three is, I think, really good, especially on kind of a trail worthy bike like this. We do have bottle cage bosses down here, so you could put a drink if you wanted to. You know, props to them for squeezing it on. Maybe you have like a little folding lock or mini pump or something. Got a slap guard here, which is nice, especially if you got the black frame, because if the chain hits it, it's gonna chip it over time, and you're gonna start to see the silver bits showing through. The drivetrain itself is a little bit more basic. We've got a 7-speed Shimano Acera. Acera is a few steps up, so it's not the lowest end derailleur. It's just, you know, 7 gears versus 9 or 10 or 11 on like higher end bikes. Thankfully, they do have that super low, like that extra large sprocket in the rear. So I think this is 14 to 34 teeth. So you have a decent range, and a lot of these smaller sprockets are designed to keep up and ride faster. And since this is an e-bike and you've got 750 watts of power, it's nice to be able to comfortably pedal with like a comfortable cadence at those higher speeds. We've also got an upgraded 12 magnet cadence sensor up front. They used to just use 6 magnets, so 12, that higher resolution, it's gonna start and stop quicker and just feel more responsive. But at any time, if you pull those brake levers, they've got integrated motor inhibitors. So that sends an instant signal like, hey, we don't wanna go anymore, and it kills the motor. So between the new cadence sensor upgrade and those motor inhibitors, I think we're doing pretty well. And the brakes themselves they're not bad. They're 180 millimeter mechanical disc brakes. You know, there are hydraulic disc brake options out on the market, but they add to the price and a little bit of complexity. If you're kind of a DIY person, you want to adjust these brakes yourself, you can get down here with an Allen key and you can tighten that wire and stuff. The trade-off is that it does take a little bit more hand effort because there's more friction going on through the tubing there. The larger levers, those are 4-finger. They do have the rubberized edge, and I like that they've got this little integrated bell. So again, I feel like it's top of the line for what they are, but it's spec down, kind of like the fork, kind of like the drivetrain, just to hit that nice price point. And I think for most people, that's gonna be pretty good. And I, you know, while we're back here, I should mention the front wheel has quick release built in. So it's a 9mm skewer, easy to take that wheel off, and that might be worth doing. The wheel plus the 7.7 pound battery pack, you take those off, it's gonna make the bike easier to lift and store if you need to put it in the back of your truck or something like that. The rear wheel, you have to use tools. See, it's just got a nut right here. This is a 12 millimeter axle with 10 millimeter flats, and those flats slip into this dropout, and that's what the motor pushes against. So it pushes against the frame when it's powering forward. Those flats are kind of wedged in there, but they've also got a torque arm. So that's a stainless steel little piece right there. It looks like a washer, but that's going to give this a little bit of extra strength and durability over time, which is important when you're really putting that much power through it and maybe in bumpy terrain. Love that they've got the kickstand mounted way out of the way of those pedals. It's adjustable length. It keeps the bike from falling over.
just done right. So much of this bike is done well and thoughtfully kind of balanced out. Whether you just ride it like this or you decide to upgrade and get that front rack, I think it's rated up to 275 pounds total. And the racks, you know, I'm not completely sure. A lot of times they're like 40 or 50 pounds. So it sort of depends on how you outfit this thing. But I feel like it's really balanced. And one of the things I love about the front rack that they've designed is that it doesn't turn when you turn the bike. Okay, so if I'm steering and stuff, I don't want the basket like creating this momentum and dumping. I want it set up just like this. This is perfect. And that rack can also be used on any of their other models as well. So for 2018, they've got those different mounting parts. And they've even got a little light extension piece that comes with the rack, so you can mount that to the basket. One downside is, again, the light's not gonna turn if you get this basket. But I still feel like it was the right choice. They've done a good job. And over here, you can even see they've used metal connector points, so they're a little bit more sealed against water and stuff. Just nice. And the black is kind of my favorite because all the accessories really blend in and the wires even start to hide. Even though they're internally routed, they're pretty nicely done. I mean, you know, they stick out a little bit at the bottom right here, but a lot of bikes do that. And part of that serviceability, even the controller unit here, see how it's separate? It's not built into the battery. I think it kind of reduces like failure and stuff. And in terms of water resistance, I was asking them like, well, you know, how sealed is this? And they said, oh, it's fully potted. It's highly water resistant. Again, we live in Seattle. We've got this sealed headset up here, sealed bottom bracket is square tapered. So a little bit more basic on that, but gets the job done. And then we have alloy chain guides. So this is a big deal for me as someone who's riding with pants all the time. I don't want my pants touching that greasy chain. I also don't want the chain to bounce off if we're on this kind of a dirt road or maybe like a pothole set up somewhere around town. It's just nice. And there's that slap guard again on the black one. So I'm here with Mike Radenbaugh. He's one of the founding members of Rad Power Bikes. Hey, buddy.
Hey, man.
Can you help me get the battery off of the white one over here? I think that's one of the big highlights for 2018 is just the redesigned battery. And one of the neat features about it is, in addition to being removable, just like that, it slides right up. It's got, I guess, exposed fuses, so it's a little bit easier to replace if there's a problem. And those fuses are important so that the battery is kind of stable and reliable. You know, and then the other side here, that was the plug. Here's the locking core. So it does three different things. You unlock and take the battery off. You can lock and have it turned off so no one can tamper with your display. So again, this is still locked to the frame, but it's in the off mode. Or you can turn it to on, and you pull out the key, and then you're ready to ride. So it's a nice little backup for someone who's worried about leaving their bike at the bike rack. And, you know, this does have a throttle and stuff. That's where we're going to go next. You know, and I think in the past it was like, you don't want someone messing around with this. The bike won't actually start until you've locked it to the frame. So Mike's going to go ahead and do that now. Just sticks the key in, locks it, pulls it out. Got a little battery, kind of a LED readout here that tells you how full it is. And then we come up here to the cockpit and hold the power button. Blinks to life very quickly. This is it's like a Rad Power Bikes branded King meter. You know, I've seen this on a lot of bikes. I like that it has this adjustable angle built in so you can reduce glare. It's not removable, so someone who commutes, you know, this might take some sun and a little bit of rain. Hopefully no one's scratching it accidentally. It does have a little USB port built in, so this is a 5-volt, 1-amp power output, and they have a little accessory so you can mount your phone next to it if you want. It's a nice cockpit, and it's large enough that people who are sitting upright and a little bit further back should still be able to see it. So we've got a 5-bar battery indicator, an odometer, and if you hit the mode button over here, it switches to trip meter, speed in the middle, and then pedal assist at the bottom. It starts off in 1, but you can also take it down to 0 and the throttle still works. So throttle on demand, full power. You don't have to like be clicking the arrows or anything. I really appreciate that. And then of course, all the way up to level 5. That's gonna be the highest level of assist, the most zippy. It's gonna get you up to that 20 mile per hour top speed, and then a watt readout. That tells you how much power the motor's putting out with you. And then over here on the left, one more thing is if you hold the up arrow, it goes from current speed to average speed to max speed. So there's really a lot in this display. Even a walk mode, if you hold the down arrow for a second, see that rear wheel? It's gonna help you out. And that's pretty useful. Like, let's say you do get a flat tire, or maybe you've got this thing loaded up and you're on a trail. Like, this is actually, bikes aren't allowed on this trail. We just came here because it's beautiful. So we could use walk mode instead of pushing that 66.5 pound bike like up the trail. And then the other thing you can do is hold the up and mode button, and that activates the headlight. So again, really nice there. Pretty bright light. And then on the rear light, I'm glad they have one, but it's kind of basic, right? It just uses its own little AAA batteries here. You have to press the power button like that. It's easy to forget and then forget to turn it off once you arrive at your destination and get excited about whatever you're doing. It can also get blocked if your coat hangs down behind your saddle. It can get blocked if you have the rear rack. There's a lot of situations where I would, you know, probably add a separate light to the back of this rack if I got it. Yeah, it's just, it's something that's like, I guess I like that it has it at all. And then one of the neat features is that if you press it again, it turns into flash mode, which is a little bit brighter. So in a perfect world, this would have an integrated headlight, an integrated tail light, you know, an air suspension and all this, but it would end up costing like $2,000, maybe even $3,000 for all those features. And for, you know, the big takeaway here is between the new ergonomic, like upright seating position that they've got, and that some of the upgrades on the fork and the battery position, the battery capacity, I'm pretty stoked. You know, these guys have been doing a good job for quite a while. And now they're available in Europe. They call it like the Rad Rhino. And they also have Canada. So if you live there, you can get the free shipping and stuff. But in Canada, it's spec'd at like 500 watts because they're trying to obey like the local ordinances and stuff. The hardware is probably very similar. It's probably still very torquey and capable. But, you know, it's like a big, you know, Rad Power Bikes one trying to do a good job and follow all the local rules. So I feel like we've gone through most of the different features of this and might be a good chance to actually hop on and ride it. I know I'm excited. I want to call out that little integrated bell. It's one of my favorite things. Just real friendly. And then those risers, 210 millimeter, 120 millimeter. Nice looking thing. Oh, and then, how could I forget? One of my favorites, you got these Welgo aluminum alloy platform pedals with big nubs on it, so you're not going to slip off as much. And if you have bigger feet, you get more surface area, so you can transfer your power directly into the bike. This is way better than like plastic pedals and stuff. And it's something that I've bought myself aftermarket, but it's $25 here, $25 there. It starts to add up. So this bike has a lot of great features built in. And you know, if you do need the fenders or some of these other accessories, you can buy them from Rad Power Bikes, and they're guaranteed to work and they look nice and everything. So that's a big takeaway. I think you guys have done a pretty good job on that stuff. Okay guys, we're turning onto sort of a side street here. Shouldn't be very crowded. I wanted to call out that this year, 2018, Rad Power Bikes has moved to the Samsung 35E cells. They're higher energy density. It's a pretty nice, you know, battery pack they've got going, and it's $499 for a replacement pack or a second pack. So if you're someone who wants to go super far and you've got the rack and everything, you can get one of those. So here I am rocking it in assist level 4. Feels zippier than like the Rad City or the Wagon because of that geared motor. Really smooth, very stable because of the big, you know, extra tire width. Just tracks very nicely. You do hear the knobs a little bit more on the concrete here, but it's not bad. You know, we're at like 11, 12 miles per hour. Let's try to hit that top 20, take it up to pedal assist level 5. Oh yeah. There we go, and it just fades out nicely. Sometimes these motors can just cut out and it can feel a little bit more abrupt, but that was nice.
Very nice.
Okay guys, I got you set up, looking down at the drivetrain. I'm gonna shift through some of the gears. I'm gonna zip the motor a little bit. Those 12 magnets, it's, again, higher resolution. It responds quickly, but the motor feels pretty smooth. It's still ramping up. It's zippier than the gearless motor on the other ones, but it just feels like a good pickup. So we'll do that. Got up to 25 miles per hour there going down the hill, and there's definitely some drag. Like once the motor stops, if you're on flats, good luck going faster than 20. But down the hill, it felt stable and it got the job done. Okay, you're looking forward at the suspension fork. We're still on a hill, so I'm gonna go down, try to get some high speed, maybe do a little bit of off-road and try to get some of that suspension action.
super plush.
So Mike's got all the fun gear on his bike set up for, I mean, all kinds of adventures, maybe like a camping trip or something. I'm digging the graphics and stuff. It's a minor update from 2017, but it's a little cleaner, nice looking. And the pant leg thing, I just wanted to show you again how that little chain guide really helps clear your pants and keep the whole thing set up well. One of the other big takeaways for me with the 2018, you know, I've always been kind of critical of this shifter and said, well, at least it's got big buttons. If you're wearing gloves like I am today, you can reach them. But I asked the folks at Rad Power Bikes and said, well, you know, we use this shifter because we've got this on-off switch for the throttle right here. So you can disable the throttle. If we had trigger shifters, it'd be difficult to reach them. They'd kind of get blocked. So that makes a lot of sense. And I just, again, I love how you can have the throttle or not have the throttle. You can all the way on the throttle. You know, it's pretty neat to have those different those settings, because everyone rides a little bit differently. And in some places, you might not want the throttle at all. So there's a lot of features. Hey guys, we're back inside. It's warm at the headquarters. And I wanted to emphasize again this derailleur guard here, especially on the Rad Rover. You know, we've got the big off-road tires and everything, but sometimes you're parked really close to other bikes at a rack, or maybe the bike tips over, you're putting it in the back of your truck. It's nice to protect that power cable that's coming out of that hub motor there, as well as the derailleur. Okay, and so I feel like this derailleur guard does it. In fact, you can even see here, this one's a little scraped up from who knows what. But that's a little bit different from the Rad City and some of the other bikes they have. So here's the Rad City step through, and you can see that there's only a derailleur cable over here. It doesn't have a motor cable. That's because this one's using the Shengyi gearless direct drive motor, and it has a power cable coming out on the left side, which is a little bit more protected. It's kind of tucked in along the frame. So I think that design is superior in terms of power cable, but this one's smoother. It's a little bit quieter, and this is the heavier motor, again, compared to the geared design, which you can see here on the Rad Rover and also on the Rad Mini, and it has the same derailleur guard and everything. So, you know, that's the way those are designed, the Bafang motors and stuff, and if they have to be that way, then at least you've got some good protection. Mike, thank you so much. Had a lot of fun out here exploring some of this northern wilderness, I guess. We're hanging out, again, near Seattle on beautiful trail, trying to avoid the rain. I'm just stoked. I feel like you guys have really enhanced your offering, and I like that the batteries are compatible across the range. So if someone in your family owns like the new Step Through model, and then someone else owns the Rad Rover or whatever, they're not backwards compatible to 2017, but going forward, it seems like this is your new, you know, design. So I like it. For the full write-up on this, including standover height, width, length, all that stuff, so you can make sure it fits in your garage, I'll see you back at electricbikereview.com. Of course, chime in with any questions or comments or feedback you've got, and we'll do our best to answer you. Cheers.